Now in this segment, we'll move on to looking at solving the transient heat conduction problem in the homework 5 template. If we look over here, now that we're solving a transient problem, we have to apply initial conditions. And I've actually set up most of this for you. What we need to do is we loop through all of our nodes and we check the position of each node. And depending on the position of the node, we'll define the initial temperature at that node. Pretty straightforward. You'll just need to insert those values. In some cases, it actually depends on the x value of the node itself as a function, okay? But all that information is given in the homework, and you just need to calculate the value. Now that takes care of D naught, storing the values of the initial values of the temperature in D trans. But now we will also need the initial values for V. We need V naught. And so to do that, we will solve a matrix vector system. Okay? Now remember, this problem is based on this equation. We have M times V plus K times D is equal to F. F in this problem is, of course, zero, but in general it wouldn't, and it could be changing with respect to time. Actually, all of these objects could be changing with respect to time, potentially. So we can also put the initial values in this equation. And if we need to solve for V naught, well, first we move KD over to the right-hand side. This becomes our right-hand side vector. And then simply do a matrix inversion to solve for V naught. Now in this problem, the mass matrix and the stiffness matrix don't change with respect to time, which is why I can get away with calling the symbol system only once. Okay, so let's look in the code at how I'm doing this matrix inversion and how I'm doing these matrix vector operations. Okay, I've done all of these for you because you'll be doing several of these on your own within the solve trans function. Okay, so first, I set RHS equal to K times D trans. And to do that, I use this dot Vmult function. Now with sparse matrices, it will do a matrix vector multiplication. I pass in RHS and D trans, and it's acting on my sparse matrix K. But what it does is it stores within RHS the values of K times D trans, okay? In the next step, I just take RHS times equals minus 1. Essentially, I'm just changing the sign on all the components of my RHS vector. Okay, so at this point, RHS is equal to minus K times D trans, or minus K times D naught. And then finally, even though F is equal to 0 in this case, I've included it for generality. I do RHS dot add 1 times F. 1 is a scalar coefficient to F. And so that takes RHS and adds onto it 1 times F, which is now gives us a right-hand side vector of F minus K times D trans, or F minus K times D naught. Okay, so now my right-hand side vector is set up. In this case, I'm only doing a matrix inversion on M, so I don't have to do any matrix operations there, but I did, up here, copy M into the system matrix. Okay, so that's the same as saying system matrix equals M. Now that all these data objects are set up, I can apply my boundary values. Now note that since I'm solving for V trans in this case, I will apply boundary values of V. The matrix that I'm inverting is system matrix. The solution is V trans. The right-hand side vector is RHS. Now I create this sparse direct UMF pack matrix A, which copies over from system matrix, and then I do my matrix inversion. Now it may be a little confusing. I do A dot Vmult here, but you notice it's doing a matrix inversion and then multiplying it by the right-hand side vector. That's just the way the functions were named, And so you just need to remember that with the sparse direct UMF pack, sparse matrix dot vmult does the matrix inversion. However, when you're dealing with a sparse matrix and a vector, dot vmult just does the simple matrix vector multiplication without any matrix inversion, okay? All right, so with that background, let's scroll down to the solve trans function. Okay, so the first thing we do in solve trans is apply the initial conditions. So that's the function we were just looking at. And the next is to define delta t. I have delta t set here to equal 1, and that will give you a stable algorithm for all alphas. Alpha equals 0, 1 half, and 1. You're free to change that on your own. However, when you turn in your assignment, leave it at delta t equals 1. Okay. I've declared this vector d tilde, which you remember we use as we're updating from dn to dn plus 1. And then we go into our time loop. Now I'm going to point out here that we are using the v method here, okay? And so we'll look over those equations as we go through this code. All right, so the first step is to find d tilde. Let me write that out for us here. So d tilde, n plus 1, again, this is a global vector, is equal to d at time n plus delta t times 1 minus alpha vn. All right. These are equations taken from the lectures, so you can look at that there. So this is step one. Step two is to use dn plus 1 tilde to find vn plus 1. And we have this system of equations here. We have m plus alpha delta tk. Again, I'm not going to rederive these. They're in the lectures. But here's the result. Sorry, we haven't quite inverted that yet. I'm going to delete that. Okay, so m plus alpha delta tk times vn plus 1 is equal to f at n plus 1, which in our case is just 0, minus k times d tilde n plus 1. All right, which of course you would then, to solve for vn plus 1, you would do a matrix inversion. So we take m plus alpha delta tk inverse times fn plus 1 minus k d tilde n plus 1. This we'll be referring to as our system matrix in the code, and this you'll set up as the right-hand side, the RHS vector. Okay, once we have vn plus 1, step 3 is to find dn plus 1, which is d tilde n plus 1 plus alpha delta t vn plus 1. Okay? Note in the code, dn at this point is d trans, vn is also v trans. Here we update v trans to be vn plus 1, and at this step we're updating d trans, sorry, that's a capital D in our code. We're updating d trans to be dn plus 1. Okay? So we'll be following these three steps in the code itself. Okay, so let's go back to the code. You'll notice I've given a list here of how to perform these matrix vector operations. A lot of these we've already seen above in the apply initial conditions function. You can use this the same dot add function with the system matrix like we did with the vector. Again, dot vmult will do a matrix vector multiplication. If you want to set m equal to, or system matrix equal to a vector, or to a matrix, excuse me, you would use copy from. However, with the vector, you can just say RHS equals F, for example. We already saw this operator times equals with a vector to change the sign. Okay, so that should be enough for you to be able to do all of these matrix vector operations. Okay? All right, so the first step, again, was to find detailed. And again, at this point, dtrans does hold the values of d sub n, and vtrans holds the value of v sub n. Okay, so once you've found dtrans, you will then create system matrix, as we wrote on the board, and RHS, again, as we wrote on the board. Once you've done that, we apply boundary values of v, again, because vtrans, or vm plus 1, is the solution vector we're solving for. So we apply boundary values of v using the system matrix that you've defined and the RHS vector. Okay, and that matrix inversion happens here with these three lines. Again, using a sparse direct UMF pack matrix A. Okay, once you've done that matrix inversion and vtrans is now equal to vn plus 1, you can use d tilde and vn plus 1, vtrans, to solve for dn plus 1. Okay, and there you have the solution for this time step. The last thing to do is to output results. Now I have it set to output results every 1,000 time steps. You'll notice I'm using this modulo operator. So every time t step, the current time step index divided by 1,000 gives a remainder of 0, then we'll output the transient results as a VTK file, and I'll also store the L2 norm of the results in this L2 norm results. I'll calculate the L2 norm of the difference between the transient solution at this current time step and the steady state solution. I'll store that within this vector here. Okay. All right. So the last step after outputting results, or the last function, I should say, after the output results functions, is to calculate the L2 norm. This is going to be very similar to the L2 norm that you calculated in homework 2, except, of course, now you can use DL2's basis functions. You'll still need to interpolate to find u steady and u transient in exactly the same way you interpolated to find uh, your finite element solution at each quadrature point. And then you will construct the integrand of, you know, the square of u trans minus u steady. Okay? And then we return the square root of that value to actually calculate the L2 norm itself. All right, so that should be pretty straightforward with what you've seen before. And that concludes our discussion of the template for homework 5.